ओके हेलो. सो वील स्टार्ट विद द क्लास. सो लास्ट क्लास वी स्टार्टेड विद द नेगोशिएबल इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स एक्ट एंड वी ऑल्सो लुक्ड एट द हिस्ट्री ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर लेजिस्लेशन. सो दिस एक्ट केम इन टू फोर्स बिफोर इंडियाज इंडिपेंडेंस, राइट? सो दैट मीन्स बिफोर दिस पर्टिकुलर एक्ट केम इन टू फोर्स वॉट हैपन वॉज दैट वी वेर गवर्न बाय द इंग्लिश कॉमन लॉ. And then after a lot of like efforts, after four tries of drafting, this particular act finally came into force. So we started with Negotiable Instruments Act 1881. Now moving to the content of this particular legislation. This legislation is having 17 chapters that we saw in last class, and it has 147 sections. So there are 147 sections and they are divided into 17 parts, and each of these chapters, they talk about different aspects of negotiable instruments. Now all of these are not important, so whatever points are important or whatever sections are important, we will be discussing that. These two dates were important: the date when it was enacted, 9th of December 1881, the date when it came into force, 1st of April 1882. Again, there are three types of negotiable instruments, and the term negotiable instrument is defined under section 13 of the act. And the three types of instruments that we see are promissory notes, defined under section 4, bills of exchange, defined under section 5, then checks, defined under section 6 of the act. So in last class, we discussed about these two types of promissory notes. Today, we will discuss about checks. So what is negotiable instrument? It basically is a type of written document which can be transferred. So negotiable instrument basically means a certain type of a written document which can be transferred from one person to another. So instruments mean a written document, and negotiable means transferable. It can be transferred by two ways: endorsement and delivery. We will discuss these two modes also today. Then we saw some of the features of negotiable instrument, that it should be certain, it must be written, it must be signed, the amount should be specified, and all of that. And also we saw that currency notes are not considered as negotiable instruments. Even though there is a promise to make a certain sum of payment, currency notes are not included under this particular act. So it would include those three types of instruments: promissory note, bills of exchange, and checks. Apart from these, there might be certain type of other customary instruments like hundis, etc., where if the parties decide that they should be governed by this particular act, this act may be applicable. Or if the customary rules or practices are silent regarding how a matter is to be resolved, then also this particular act may be applicable. Then section 4 is what defines the promissory note, and this is how a promissory note looks like. So in general, we would mention the amount, place, date, and who is making a promise to make a payment to whom. That thing also we will mention. So these are some examples of promissory notes. First is, I promise to pay B500 on 15th of June 2020. So here we are specifying the time when payment would be made, specifying the amount that would be paid, and also mentioning who will be making the payment to whom. So this is a type of promissory note. Secondly, it says, I acknowledge myself to be indebted to B in 1000 rupees to be paid on demand for the value received. So in this case, what happens is that date is not mentioned. So it is saying on demand. Wherever the other person demands by showing this promissory note, the amount would be paid. So this also would be an example of promissory note. Even though date is not mentioned, it says on demand it shall be payable. I will make the payment. But these would not be examples of promissory note, because maybe the amount is not certain, the person is not certain, or some or the other thing is missing. So this is an example. One person buys laptop from another person and says, later on I will make the payment. Date is also specified. So that particular promise would be a type of promissory note. Then bills of exchange is defined under section 5, where it says that it is like an unconditional order. So order means the person from whom he has bought, right? That person, the creditor, would make this particular instrument. So this is made by the creditor. So we need acceptance from the debtor also. So debtor should also give his acceptance that I accept this instrument and I agree to make the payment accordingly. There are three parties, drawer, drawee, and payee. The person who makes it, to whom, who will make the payment, and this is to whom payment would be given. Drawer and payee may be the same person also in some cases. And this is a format of bills of exchange. So here what happens is that the time would be specified that after 60 days from this particular date, you should pay 2 lakh rupees or 3 lakh rupees, whatever the amount is. It should be signed by the person and it should be also accepted by the person. Again, features of bills of exchange, we discussed that it should be written, it should be certain, it should not be, there should not be any conditions or any other thing. Differences are that promissory note is section 4 that defines promissory note. Bills of exchange is defined under section 5. There are two parties in promissory note, but there are three parties in a bills of exchange. It contains a promise, but in bills of exchange, it's like an order. It is issued by debtor, the person who will make the payment. It is issued by the creditor to whom payment should be made. There is no concept of acceptance because the person himself is making it, but your acceptance is needed for it to be valid. Drawer and payee cannot be the same person. One person cannot make a promise to pay himself, but here it may be the same person. So we also discussed some of these questions in last class. So this date and all that we discussed. And today we will start with the remaining topics for this. Okay, so for negotiable instrument, we should know what negotiation means. Now the term negotiation is defined under section 14. So what is negotiation? It does not mean negotiation, right? It basically means transferring something to the other person. So the term negotiation is defined under section 14. What is it? It says when a promissory note, bills of exchange or check is transferred to any person, so as to constitute that person as the holder thereof, the instrument is said to be negotiated. So we all know what is negotiable instrument. It basically consists of two words, negotiable and instrument. Negotiable means transferable. Instrument means a certain type of a written document. How many times it can be transferred? It can be transferred n number of times till the date of maturity or till the date when it is made payable. So what negotiation means? It basically means any type of instrument which is transferred from one person to another, that process would be called as negotiation. And it is defined under section 14. Section 13 defines what is negotiable instrument, what all things are included in negotiable instrument. Now, how this transfer would be made, there are two different ways. So we know that negotiable instruments may be transferred and it can be transferred n number of times till the date of maturity or till the date when the payment is due. It can be done by two ways. What are these two ways? First is by endorsement and second one is by delivery. So in case of endorsement, what happens? If name of a person is written, so it may be bill promissory note, it may be bills of exchange, it may be check. What happens is that name of the person is written to whom payment is to be made. So in such cases, it can be transferred by way of endorsement. How? The person whose name is written, he can do what? He can put his signature and mention to whom he want to, he wants that the payment should be made. So he can do it by way of endorsement, by putting his signature, it may be by writing name of the person, and then the process of transfer would take place. Another type is by delivery. In delivery, what happens? If name of the person is not mentioned in that particular instrument, then it can be transferred simply by way of delivery. For example, I have a check with me where my name is not written or anyone's name is not written. So what I can do is that I can simply transfer that particular check to someone else and transfer would be completed. So it would be called as a bearer instrument. The person, whoever is holding it, that person can go to the bank and then get the amount. So these are the two different ways of transferring a negotiable instrument, and it is defined under Section 14 of the NI Act. Now it is, what is endorsement? It is defined under Section 15. So endorsement basically means what? It is a legal signature on some financial document. That means if I have a check that I want to transfer it to someone else, like my name is written there, but I want to transfer it to someone else. So what I can do is that I can put my signature on that particular paper, mention name of the person, and then get it transferred to the other person. So if I want to transfer it to someone, what I can do is that maybe I can put my signature on backside of that particular page, or I can attach another paper and then write on that paper name of the person and then put my signature. So, or what happens is that in a stamped paper also I can do it. And then it would be called as endorsement is done in reference to that particular negotiable instrument, and it has been transferred from my side to the other person. So endorsement is defined under Section 15 of the Negotiable Instruments Act. Is this part clear? Any doubts, anyone? So now we know what endorsement is, right? So endorsement may be of two different types. How endorsement can be made? It can be made in two different ways. First is in blank and second is in full. So Section 16 talks about the different ways of endorsing a certain type of a negotiable instrument. What happens here is that if the endorser signs his name only, so what I can do, for example, I have a check with me where my name is written and I want to get it transferred to a certain other person. So what I can do in that particular case is that I can write name of that other person, put my signature after that. That means it is endorsement in full because I have put my signature also and also mentioned name of the person to whom I want it to get transferred to, right? But in blank means what? I have left that particular thing blank. I have just put my signature. So that means whoever is holding it, that person can go to the bank and then get that particular amount. So no one's name is written basically, but I can just put my signature to show that I'm, transferring it to someone else. And then that particular person can go to the bank, deposit it, and then get the amount. So these are the two different ways of endorsing a negotiable instrument that we have. Now we will discuss the third type of negotiable instrument that is mentioned under the NI Act. So the third type of negotiable instrument that we have is check, and it is defined under Section 6 of the NI Act. What is check? Check is also considered as a type of bill of exchange only under NI Act. But what happens is that on certain grounds, it is different from bills of exchange. So it is mentioned under a separate section, but it can be considered as somewhat similar to a bills of exchange. So what is check? As per Section 6, it is a form of bills of exchange only that is drawn on a specified bank and is payable only on demand. For example, in case of promissory note, what happened is that, for example, I am buying something from a person without paying him the money. I will make a promise that on this particular date, I will make the payment. So on that particular date, I should make the payment, right? It is not like on demand. It should be the date, whatever is specified, on that particular day only, I will make the payment. In case there is a bills of exchange also, it would be on that particular specified date only. So for promissory note and bills of exchange, what happens is that usually a date would be specified, and on that particular date or before that particular date, what happens is that I should make the payment. But it is not so in case of check. In case of check, what happens? The date when it is issued, right? This, but on this particular section, date would be mentioned. So whatever date is mentioned in this particular section, 30 days from this particular date, this check would be considered as valid. But for example, I am issuing a check to a certain person. I have also mentioned a certain date over here, right? If the person do not submit this check to the bank within like 3 months, what happens is that payment would not be made to him. Why? Because he should demand this particular payment. So the person to whom a check is issued, he should submit that particular check to the bank and get the payment. That means he is demanding the money, that I have this particular check of maybe 10,000, 50,000, whatever the amount is, and I want this particular money. So check is considered that it is always payable on demand. It is payable on demand. But in case of promissory note and bills of exchange, usually a date would be mentioned, and on that particular date, it should be paid. No matter whether the person is reminding the other one or not, it should be paid on that particular date. But in case of check, unless and until demand is raised by the person, it is not like a bank will not come to know about it, and payment would also not be made. So it should be within 3 months from this particular date, the person should raise a demand by submitting it to the bank. So section 6 of the NI Act defines what a check is, and it is considered as a form of bills of exchange, and it is said that it would be payable only on demand. So this is like the basic difference of check with bills of exchange or with promissory notes, that check is always paid on demand, but in other two cases, it would be on the date only. So check contains an unconditional order. It is what? It is again an unconditional order. For example, this is your check. A person's name is written over here, and whoever is issuing the check, he would put his signature here. That means what? It is like an unconditional order given to HDFC Bank that from this particular account that I have, you make a payment of ₹50,000 to this particular person whose name I have mentioned. So there are no other conditions mentioned here, right? The person is not saying that, only if I'm having sufficient funds with me, only if this, only if that. No other conditions are mentioned. If sufficient fund is not there in the account, it is responsibility of this particular person only who is issuing that particular check. So when issuing this check, he need to ensure that he is having that much amount with him. Otherwise, it is his liability, not liability of the bank or the other person. So check is what? It is considered as a type of unconditional order where without any conditions or without any other thing, the person or the account holder is giving an order to this particular bank that from this particular account, you should make a payment of this particular rupees to a certain person. So it is always what? It is always an unconditional order containing signature of the drawer. So the person who is making the check, he should put his signature over here and give to the bank to pay a certain sum of money on demand. And it will be always on demand. Unless and until this particular person submits it to the bank and demands this payment, bank would not come to know about it and no payment would be made. So it is always paid on demand. And it includes the electronic image of a truncated check and a check in electronic form also. So these two terms we will be discussing later, what these two terms are. So basically under section 6, what a check is. Check is a type of bill of exchange, but it is on certain grounds different from that of bills of exchange. It is payable only on demand, but bills of exchange would be payable on the date mentioned. It is what? It is like an unconditional order that is given to the bank, and signature of the drawer would also be put in that particular check. So two other things are also mentioned here. It is truncated check and check in electronic form that we will be discussing now. Okay, so now this is how the check would look like. If a person wants to transfer it to someone, what he can do is that on backside of this particular check, he can put his signature. He can again put his signature like that, and he can mention name of the person to whom he wants to transfer it. Or what he can do is that he can attach another like page or paper on this, and he can mention that he wants to transfer it to so and so person. So like that, transfer can be made. Now there are three parties to a check. Who are these three parties? It is drawer, drawee, and the payee. Now who is the drawer? Drawer means who made the check or issued it. So the person who is issuing the check, who is holding that particular account, who he would be called as the drawer. Drawee would be the bank, that particular. For example, a person is having his account in HDFC Bank and he wants to issue a check. So the person who will put his signature here in order to issue the check, he would be the drawer. This HDFC Bank would be the drawee, and payee will be this particular person whose name will be mentioned here. That pay to this particular person. But sometimes what happens that it can be a bearer check also. That means if you see here, it is mentioned pay. Then name of the person we can put. And if we are leaving it blank, what happens is that or bearer. That means we are not specifying name of any person. Whoever is carrying this particular check can get the amount from bank. So it would be considered as a bearer check or a bearer instrument that we are not specifying to whom the payment is to be made. So these are the three different parties to a check. Drawer, drawee, and the payee. Again, these are the three different persons who can be there in a check. But for example, what happens is that in one case, for example, the check is transferred to another person, right? So the check is made by this particular person and then he issues it to a certain person and the other person wants to transfer it by way of endorsement. So what happens in that particular case is that holder, if the check is endorsed, the original payee would be called as the holder. So originally to whom this check was issued, that particular person would be called as the holder, the original payee. Who will transfer this particular check would be the holder in this particular case if the check is endorsed. And who would be the endorsee? The other person to whom we are, transferring this particular check, and who would be getting the money after this. So it would be called as the endorsee, the other person to whom we want to transfer the case. So in general cases, there would be three persons when a check is made, like originally the drawer, the person who is holding this particular account, he would put his signature and issue the check. The drawee would be the bank where he is holding his account, to which bank he is giving the direction to make the payment. And payee would be the person whose name would be written here. If name is not written, it would be a bearer check. And in case it is transferred, then what happens is that the original payee, we call him as the holder because he is originally holding the check, who would transfer it to someone else. And when it gets transferred, the person to whom it is transferred is called as the endorsee. This is like the parties to a check and endorsement. Okay, now certain essential features of a check. In case of bills of exchange and promissory note, what happens? It is payable on the particular date or the day what is mentioned on the negotiable instrument, right? If it is mentioned that on January 5th, 2020, I promise you to pay 50,000 rupees, that means on that particular day only it should be paid. But in case of checks, what happens? Even though a date is mentioned when it is issued, and even though we know that check is having validity of 6 months, but even then it would not be paid unless and until the payee goes and demands for the money. So it would be always on demand that payment in reference to a check would be made. So first essential is that it should always be on demand. The person will have to demand the money, then only he would get paid, no matter whether like it is whether even though we know that the validity of the check is 3 months, even then it would not be paid unless and until a demand is made. Now, even though considered as a type of bills of exchange, so under section 6 also it is mentioned, right, that check is what? It is a type of bills of exchange. So even though it is considered as a type or a form of bills of exchange, checks do not need any form of formal acceptance. So in bills of exchange, what we studied is that one person will make an order to the other person, right? For example, if A is buying, so for example, if A is buying laptops from another person worth rupees 50,000. So what A can from B. So what B will do in this particular case is that B will issue a bills of exchange and will make an order to A that he should make the payment of 50,000 rupees on maybe like 10th of July 2020. So in this particular case, what happens is that B is issuing a bill of exchange and making an order to A that you should pay 50,000 rupees to me on 10th of July. So in this particular case, what happens is that A has to accept this bills of exchange in order for it to become a valid document. But in case of check, we do not need any sort of acceptance. Why? Because the person who is making the payment, he himself is issuing this particular instrument. So there is no concept of acceptance or anything in promissory note also, in checks also. But only in case of bills of exchange, we need a certain type of formal acceptance. Why? Because it is made by the other person. One person is ordering the other one to make a payment. So the other person has to accept that particular order. Only then we can demand for the payment. So in other two things, we do not need any type of formal acceptance. So checks do not need any type of formal acceptance. Now, checks may be paid to the payee or to the bearer on demand. So what happens in case of check is that there is a place that is there, right? We can mention name of a person to whom we want that payment should be made under this particular check. So if name is mentioned here, then the payment would be made to this particular person only. If name is not mentioned, what happens is that it would be paid to the bearer. Bearer means whoever is holding the check, whoever goes and presents it to the bank, that person would be entitled for the payment because no one's name is mentioned there. So check may be payable to the payee or the bearer on demand. But whomever it is payable, what happens is that it should always be on demand only. So on demand only we can, bank will make the payment, otherwise not. Even though we know regarding the validity and all, bank will not make the payment unless and until it is presented before the bank and payment is demanded from bank. Next is the validity of checks are fixed under negotiable instruments that it is 3 months period from the date when it is issued. But in case of other instruments, what happened is that we do not have a fixed, time that is mentioned under the negotiable instruments. Like it may be 1 month, 2 months, three months, whatever the time is, it would be fixed by the parties to the instrument. So under negotiable instruments act, only for checks, we have a specified time frame that is of three months. That within 3 months, the person can demand the money by submitting it to the bank anytime within this 3 months period. So these are some of the essentials of check, that it should be paid only on demand. If the person is not demanding for the money, not presenting it before the bank, what happens is that the bank is not liable to make the payment. We do not need any type of formal acceptance in case of check, but we need a type of formal acceptance in case of bills of exchange. Even though checks are considered as a type of bills of exchange, we would not need any sort of formal acceptance for this. It would be payable to the payee if his name is mentioned. In case no one's name is mentioned, it would be payable to the bearer on demand. Whoever is presenting it to the bank, that person's, to that particular person only, it would be payable. Then time frame is 3 months that is mentioned. So this is what the third instrument is all about. That check is what? It is defined under section 6. It is a type of bills of exchange. It is an unconditional order that is made by the drawer, and it is an order given to the bank to make the payment to the payee or to the bearer. There will be three parties in case of a check also. Essentials are, these are the essentials. So any questions on these three different types of instruments that we have under NIM? Is this part clear? NIM, the three different instruments that we have, section 4, 5, 6.
Yes, ma'am.
So now we know what what are the features of a check, what a check is, which section defines it. Now there are different types of checks that are mentioned even under section 6 we saw, right? Truncated check and electronic check, it is also mentioned that check is a type of bills of exchange, and it will also include truncated checks and electronic checks also under that particular definition. Now these are the four different types of checks that we commonly see. First is a truncated check. So what is this? Is that basically, for example, one person, what he does is that, for example, this particular check only. If we take this particular check as an example, one person, he is having an account in HDFC Bank, and this is the account number. So what he does is that he mentions name of a certain person, for example, A. And he mentions that 50,000 rupees is to be paid to this particular person, and he also mentions the date. Now, if the person puts his signature and then issues this check to the to the other person, what happens is that he is giving a direction to this particular bank only, right? He is having his account in HDFC Bank only, from where the amount would be like debited. So what happens is that, for example, he issued that particular check from directing HDFC Bank. Now, the other person is having his account in SBI Bank. So what he does is that he submits the check in SBI Bank. Now, SBI Bank and HDFC Bank will have to coordinate, right, in order for the amount to be given to the other person. So during this particular process, what happens? For example, check was issued to one person. There was one person B who is having his account in HDFC Bank, and he issues a check to another person called A who is having his account in SBI Bank. Now A submits the check to SBI Bank. For SBI Bank to give that amount, what they will have to do is that SBI and HDFC Bank will have to coordinate. So SBI Bank is having the physical copy of the check once it is submitted to them, right? So what they will do is that during the clearance process, what they will do is that they will take a scanned copy of that particular check and then will transfer it to that particular other bank so that the clearing process can be done smoothly and in less time. So that particular process is called as a truncated check. So when a bank is having a physical copy of a check and it's takes a scanned copy of that particular thing for their clearance process, then that particular scanned copy would be called as a truncated check. So truncated check is when physical copy of the check is converted into a digital form. How it is converted? By scanning. Why it is done? During the process of clearance. So it would be called as a truncated process. So it would be similar to that of a physical copy only, just that in order to save time, they are just taking a scanned copy rather than transferring it physically to the other bank or to the other branch. So it would be called as a truncated check. So these types of checks are also included under the definition as per section 6 of the NIM. Another type is electronic check. In this case, what happened is that when the check was issued to the other person, when the other person submitted it to the bank, everything was done physically, right? The check was physically transferred, physically given to the other person submitted it to the bank. So everything was done physically. Only during the clearance process, it was converted in a digital form. So it is called as a truncated check. But in this other form, what happens is that the entire process is done electronically. So electronic check is what? When the account holder issues e-check. So he will not issue it in a physical form, but it would be a type of e-check that is done by using electronic device and transfers the same to the payee over a secure e-channel. So that means transfer is also not done like in a physical form, but it would also be done by using some sort of a secure e-check channel, and through that only it would be transferred to the other person. And what the person will do, whoever is issuing this particular check, he will use his digital signature only while doing it. So everything would be done electronically. So it is called as an electronic check. But in case of truncated check, what happens? It is just like the normal type of check that we see, but it is only done by banks that while, during their clearance process, they would take a scan copy of it and would get it cleared. So this is what is called as a truncated check. So these two types of checks are mentioned under Section 6, that the definition would also include these two types of checks also. So any dispute or anything arising regarding these checks also would be covered under NI Act only. So persons cannot be like the definition is not including this particular type of check, so we are not bound under the Negotiable Instruments Act. It cannot be so. So these two things are also included under it. So Section 6 definition is what? Check is a form of bills of exchange drawn on a specified bank and is payable only on demand. Hence, the check contains an unconditional order. So why it is drawn on a specified bank? Because in case of check, what happens? It would be from a certain account only, right? We cannot just make a check of ourselves and then give it to any bank account that I have. You can get this particular amount. It cannot be that. We would specify from which account, from which bank we want the money to be debited. So it is always on a specified bank only that we are giving this particular order. So in this case, it would be HDFC Bank only. So now these were the two types that are mentioned under negotiable under the definition. So other two types that we have are order check and bearer check. So these two types are not mentioned because the term check itself includes these two types also. So it is like clear enough that these two things would also be included in the definition. So they have not like specifically mentioned it in the definition, but these two types are mentioned specifically. So what is an order check? If one check is issued in name of a certain person, so what happens in that particular case is that it would be called as an order check. Why? Because for example, in a check, we mention name of a person. For example, Rahul Sharma, name of a person is mentioned. That means what? The person who is having an account in HDFC Bank, that particular person is giving an order to HDFC Bank to make the payment to this person only. So in that particular case, the check would be considered as an order check. But even though a person's name is mentioned in that particular check, the person would still have the right to transfer that check to someone else and then negotiate the same. And what happens is that this particular check. So what happens in this particular case is that this person's name is mentioned over here, right? But even though his name is mentioned, as we discussed that negotiable instrument means it can be transferred. So similarly, checks also can be transferred. In case name is not mentioned, it would be a bearer check, right? Whoever is holding it can ask for the money. But in case name of a certain person is mentioned and the person wants to transfer it to someone else, what he can do is that he can write on the backside of the check or attach another paper and then write it that he wants to transfer it to someone else. So name of that person he will write, and also he would put his signature. So on order of this particular person, it is getting transferred to someone else, and that particular person would be entitled for that money. So then in that case, it would be called as an order check. Why? Because it is not the original person who, mentioned name of a person, he is collecting the money. But what he is doing is that he is making another order that someone else will be entitled for this money, and he is transferring it to that particular person. So usually this particular cases are very rare that the person would himself take the money, even if he is also supposed to make a payment of the same amount to someone else. What they generally do is that the person would take the money and then he would transfer it to the other person himself. So transfer cases are less, but the person is having that particular right. So what is an order check? Order check basically means if the check is issued in name of a certain person and the person wants that he will not take the money, but he will further transfer it to someone, then he can endorse this particular check by writing on backside name of the other person and putting his signature. So in this case, it would be called as a type of order check. Why? Because in this particular case, negotiation will be done on order of this particular person only. Next type is bearer check. So where no one's name is written, it will be a bearer check. Because why? If no one's name is written over here, it would automatically be a bearer check. That whoever is name is not mentioned, then it would be considered as a bearer check. Or when it can be a bearer instrument, if, for example, name of this particular person is written over here, but he wants to transfer it to someone else. So what he is doing is that he is putting his signature, but he is not mentioning name of the person to whom he wants to get it transferred to. So even in case the check is negotiated and name of the person is not mentioned, at the time of an endorsement, what happens is that it will be considered as a bearer check. So this particular person has the right to decide whether he wants to make it an order check or a bearer check. So we discussed, right, in endorsement what happens, there are two types. It may be in blank or in full. So if it is in full, that means what, name of the person is also written, his signature is also put. So if it is in full, it would mean an order check. If it is in blank, then it may become a bearer check also. That my signature, I have put my signature, but I have not mentioned to whom it should be transferred or who is supposed to get this particular amount. So it would be endorsement in blank, and the check would be considered as, and the check would not be an order check, but it would be a bearer check. So these are the four different types of checks that we have. After types of checks, we will move to crossing of check. So you must have seen crossing of checks, right? That it looks something like this, that two lines would be put over here. So this is called as crossing of check. Now we will see what are the different types of crossing and why crossing is basically done. So if a check is crossed, it would be considered as a cross check. So what is cross check? If the check is crossed, the payment for the same can be received only in an account and not in counter. Even in counter also we can get the payment, right? For example, one person is holding an account in HDFC bank, but what he is not having is that he is not having a debit card. So he wants money from that particular account. What the person can do is that usually if we are having a debit card, we go to the ATM and then we get the amount. But if a person is not having a debit card, but he is holding a bank account and he is having money in that particular account, what he can do is that he can go to the counter and then he can get the amount. So he can fill some forms and he can ask for the money, like 10,000, 15,000, whatever the amount he would need, he can mention it and get the money. Similarly, in checks also, if it is not crossed, that means if these two lines are not put in the check, what he can do is that the person whose name is written or the bearer, what they can do is that they can simply go to the counter and they can demand this particular money. So if this check was not crossed and 1,000 rupees is mentioned, the person can simply go to the counter, produce this particular check and get the amount. So it would not be credited in his bank account. But in case a check is crossed, what happens in that particular case is that we cannot just simply walk to the counter, but what we need is that we need to deposit the check and then the amount would be credited in bank account only. So basically crossing of check is done so that amount is credited only to bank account of the person to whom it is issued. If a person is issuing this particular check to Rahul Sharma amounting rupees 1,000, the person wants that he takes this particular amount in his bank account only. So crossing of check basically means that amount cannot be taken directly by going to the counter. It will be credited only and only in bank account of the person. Now there are different types of checks that we see, like different types of crossings that we see. So basically crossing means what? That it cannot be taken in counter, amount will go to the bank account only. What are these different types of crossings? First is checks crossed generally. So it is defined under section 123 of the NIN. What is checks crossed generally? Check will be crossed and inside the lines, name of the company may be written. Then the check may be taken in bank account of that company only and not in the counter. So what happens in this particular case, for example, the person writes name of a certain company to whom he wants to make the payment. For example, ABC Private Limited is written inside this particular crossed lines. So in that case, what happens? It basically means that this particular company can take the amount of 1,000 rupees only in their bank account. Because we know that crossing means it goes only to bank account. So if it is crossed generally mentioning name of the person or the name of the company, it would go to their bank account only. So it is not needed, like we are not specifying to which bank account it will go. Even though the person is issuing the check from HDFC bank, the company may be having their account in SBI bank, ICICI bank, whichever bank it is, it does not matter. But it should be in some bank account. So that, bank does not matter, but it should be a bank account only of that particular company or the person. Now, in case of checks crossed, specially what happens is that it is mentioned under section 124. When a check is crossed specially, that means what? The person would mention name of the bank as well inside those lines that he will put. So if it is crossed generally, that bank, we are not specifying the bank. It may be any bank where the person is having his account, there only the amount can be taken. But if it is crossed specially, then we are specifying name of the bank where payment can be taken. So in case we are specifying SBI or HDFC bank inside these lines that we have put, then what happens is that the person can get the money from HDFC bank only. That means the other person also should have his account in HDFC Bank, SBI Bank, whatever name is mentioned in this two lines. So these are the two different types of crossings that we have generally, checks crossed generally, that is mentioned under section 123, where we are not specifying the bank, but we are only specifying that that particular person will get the amount from in his bank account only, not like going to the counter and then taking the money. And in case check is crossed specially, we are specifying the bank account also. In that bank account only, we can get the amount. Now next is check bearing not negotiable. So in those two lines, if we have mentioned not negotiable, then what happens is that the person to whom it is further transferred will not have a better title on it. That means it can still be negotiated, but in case it is negotiated, the check gets bounced or something, the other third person will not have a right to fight a case on the first person. So this is all about crossing of checks. We will continue with the remaining things in next class. Thank you.